Good morning, Wooddale Church. And as we gather together this morning in worship, may Jesus Christ be praised. I'd like to continue in this hour of worship by asking you to stand with me and hear these words from 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. I declare to you that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is because of that victory that we can gather this morning and sing praise and worship to our living and everlasting God.
Thank you.
And Heavenly Father, as we gather to worship you this morning, we can't help but look ahead and look upward for the promise that we have from you that one day we will worship you face to face. We will see you in all of your glory, and nothing will interfere or inhibit our praise. How we thank you and praise you that you have given us that hope. You have given us that assurance. But until that day, Father, comes, when we do see you face to face, we pray that our worship would be pure and true. We pray that we would not enter into it lightly, but we would go completely 100% in as we lift you up and worship you and praise you. Father, we do look forward to that time when there will be no more night, there will be no more pain, there will be nothing to interfere with our worship of you. And so until that day comes, we pray that you will accept us and accept our worship, for we give it freely and joyfully to you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
The timeless theme, earth and heaven, will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See all around, now the nations bow down to sing. The holy song is the praises to Christ the King. Slowly the names from the book are read. I know the King, so there's no need to dread. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See over there, there's a mansion prepared for me, where I can live with my Savior eternally. No more night, no more pain, no crying again, and praises to
Well, Jerry, thank you. It is always good to have Jerry with us, and just what a blessing it is to have him part of our worship service, and what a blessing it is to have you as part of our worship services. Welcome to Wooddale Church. I am so grateful that you've chosen to worship God with us here this morning. If we've not met before, my name is Kyle. I serve as the executive teaching pastor here at Wooddale, and we love to know that you joined us for service. That's one of the reasons there is a connection card that's located in the pew back in front of you. So for those of you that are here in this room, please begin to fill that out. You can drop it in the offering plate that's going to go by in just a moment. And for those of you that are joining us online this weekend, great to have you with us as well. We have a digital version of that connection card, and we'd love to know that you joined us as well. So please begin to fill that out. You know, the last several weeks, God has been reminding me of something that I know to be true, but has just been pressing into me a little bit more. And it's this truth that everything we do as followers of Jesus is response. That God's the one who initiates everything. All we do is we respond to what God's already done. So God's always working, and we just are invited to join him in his work. That God is who he is, and we choose to, or are called to respond in worship to what God has already started, what God has already initiated. Everything we do is in response. And that's been reminding me, I've just been reminded of that when we see God for who he is, it compels us to respond. Here at Wooddale Church this month, we have been in a school supply drive. We're providing school supplies for all the students in Eden Prairie who are in need. And the reason that we do that is because we're responding to who God is. God is for people, so we are for people. And it's one of the ways that we can let our community know a little bit more about who God is. So if you haven't yet participated with us in that school supply drive, there are some tags of some of the needed supplies that are still yet to be purchased. You can find those very colorful tags out in our common space on a big board. For those of you that are joining us online, there's a digital version as well, an Amazon wish list. And I would ask for you to participate in that here in the next couple of weeks. And if you've already purchased those items, please have them back here at the church at the end of July, July 30th, and we're going to collect those. But that is part of how we respond to who God is. And this upcoming week, there's an opportunity for many of us, many of you who are not yet members of Wooddale, to begin the membership process. And again, that too is a response. See, our God is a God of commitment. We didn't have anything that we could offer to God, and yet he chose to commit himself to us. And his commitment to us has changed everything about us. And so one of the ways we as followers of Jesus are to live is to then live in response by being people of commitment. So if you've been part of Wooddale Church for a number of years but have not yet committed to become a member, I want to encourage you to take that step of commitment in response to who God is. And that step can happen this Thursday. So we have a join class that's coming at 6:30 p.m. this coming Thursday. You can register online at the address that you're seeing up there on the screen. But that's a great way to respond to who God is. When it comes to the giving of our gifts and our offerings, that is also done in response to who God is. He has been so generous with us. And so one of the ways we worship him is by acknowledging that God gave to us first. And so now we choose to give to him. We're going to do that now as we present our gifts to the Lord. Please join me in prayer. Father God, we love you. We are so grateful that you are the God of initiation, that you pursued us, that you came and revealed yourself to us. And Father, one of the many ways that we can acknowledge who you are and worship you is to now respond to you by giving back part of what you have given to us. So, Father, please be honored by the gifts that we now present to you. We do this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
This is the story of God's great love for you. It's not a collection of individual stories from the past. It's one big story that God put together for us to grasp. In the beginning, God created a world filled with beauty and wonder. He placed us at the center of the story. But then sin entered the world and everything changed. We were separated from God. It doesn't end there. From the perfect beginning to the brokenness of sin, and then the redemption through Jesus, God's story continues. It's a story of restoration. It's filled with hope, purpose, and a future. It's woven through every word, every page, and every moment of your life.
Good morning, everyone. This is the last season of our series, Grasping God's Big Story. In fact, next weekend will be the last message in the entire series, so hope you'll be back for that. But we're talking about, in this last season, our future and our hope, our restoration. And so we're going to jump right in because we have a lot to uncover and enjoy today in the book of Revelation. So I've asked Pastor Dave if he would come and read for us Revelation chapter 21, verse 1 through 7. Would you stand for the reading of God's word? Thank you.
Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." And then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Amen. When those words were given by our Lord through John, they were meant for believers in every age, including our own, to be a source of hope and of inspiration. If we've ever needed hope, it certainly feels like it in these days that we're living in right now, doesn't it? There's just so much uncertainty in life. And there's all kinds of issues that are taking place, as Jesus said, wars and rumors of wars, pandemics and strange illnesses, climate issues that are taking place, increase of violence and immorality seems to be so rampant these days. In fact, we're living at a time where we're being told that there's nothing abnormal. Everything is normal, even though you know it's not normal. We're being told it's all normal. I was looking at a survey that was just recently done, and according to the statistics on this survey, it reports that 43% of Americans, only 43% of Americans, believe that there are better days ahead for our country. And I know this one won't surprise you from Gallup, but Gallup reports only 31% of Americans have any kind of confidence in the government. And so when you know you put that all together, you just realize, man, goodness, there's a lot of hopelessness, a lot of pessimism in our world and our culture today. Maybe you feel it, maybe you echo it yourself. Well, if you and I feel hopeless today, can you imagine what the first believers in Christ must have felt in the early church. I mean, they were facing what we would think of as extreme hopelessness. A lot of them were being persecuted for their willingness to follow and be obedient to Jesus. And what that meant for them was loss of family and loss of friends and loss of job and loss of life. And so we realize how significant it is when you're facing a hopeless situation to have something you can believe in and something you can hang on to that allows you to go through those experiences with some sense of confidence and some sense of encouragement. And I think today as we look at our text that's going to happen in your life and mine. But before we go into exactly what John says there in Revelation 21, I want to actually start with some words that the Holy Spirit gave the Apostle Paul to speak. These words were given for folks who were wondering about the resurrection because, listen, if there's no resurrection, the book of Revelation is useless. It's because there is a resurrection. So if you want to jot some thoughts down, I just want to remind us that as believers, we have a great hope ahead of us because Jesus is risen. Amen? That is a great hope for us. Let me just read to you some of the things that Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'll start at verse 19. He says this. He says, "And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But in fact," he says, "Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died." So you see, just as death came into the world through a man, now the resurrection for the dead has begun through another man. I like how he puts it, has begun. And of course, he's referring to Christ. Verse 22, he says, "Just as everyone dies, because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life." But there is an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised as the first of the harvest. Then all who belong to Christ will be raised when he comes back. After that, the end will come when he will turn the kingdom over to God the Father, having destroyed every ruler and authority and power. So Paul's saying is, listen, Jesus is risen from the dead. He is the first fruits, which means that if he's the first fruits, there are more to come, and that's you and that's me. I like how it's put in Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6, Jesus is portrayed as a forerunner, as a trailblazer, so to speak, who has lived and died, and death couldn't hold him, and he's resurrected and he's ascended. And as a forerunner, as a trailblazer, what that means is he's cut a path for all who put their faith in him, that we will follow in his footsteps. Yes, we will die, but death can't hold us back. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. They'll bury my body in the ground, but I'm going to be with him. And someday, the Bible says, when he returns, I'll return with him and have a resurrected body. How many of you are looking forward to your resurrected body? Yes. The older we get, the more we look forward to it, right? That's right. So I want to talk a little bit about that hope that now John speaks about. I want to explore it a little bit. And we can't look at it in great detail, but I want to explore aspects of it. So what I want to talk to you, first of all, about is the nature of this hope. The nature of this hope. Let's go back to verse 2 that David read for us. Let's read it aloud together. "And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband." Now, there's a lot we can say about this hope, but the thing I want to focus on is this whole idea, this whole concept, that this hope that we're looking forward to is a hope that actually is actually a hope that comes down to us. Now, why is that important? Well, I want to read to you a little quote by the eminent theologian N.T. Wright. And here's what he says. He says, "This," referring to what we just read, "image is that of marriage. The New Jerusalem comes down out of heaven like a bride adorned for her husband." We notice right away how drastically different This is from all those would-be Christian scenarios in which the end of the story is the Christian going off to heaven as a soul, naked and unadorned, to meet its maker in fear and in trembling. It is not we who go to heaven. It is heaven that comes to earth. Indeed, it is the church itself, the heavenly Jerusalem, that comes down to earth. It's an answer to Jesus' prayer. When he taught the disciples to pray, remember he said, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy what? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." Where? On earth as it is in heaven. When I was growing up as a kid, the picture in my mind of eternity was we leave this world, we go up to some place, and I was not sure what we were going to do after that, except maybe sit on clouds, because that's what the cartoons portrayed, and played harps, and I just thought how boring that is going to be. And I think a lot of people in our culture kind of had that mentality and mindset about what heaven is, but that is not what heaven is like. Heaven comes to earth. Our future is here in this place. Let's talk a little bit about heaven. Randy Alcorn, maybe you've heard of him, and I referred to him several years ago in a series that we did on what happens after we die, has written this massive book on heaven. It's more like an encyclopedia. It's not something you just sit down and read. You just kind of use it as a reference. But he has some really interesting things to say to us. And one of the things that Randy reminds us of is we have to be careful that we don't associate God with heaven. And here's what he means by this. Now, when I'm saying heaven right now, I'm not talking about the stars and the sky and the sun, the galaxies. All that's going to be remade, just like the earth is going to be remade someday. You know, when I'm referring to heaven right now, I'm talking about that space that God most inhabits. Remember, God fills up space. Space cannot contain him. Yet the Bible makes it clear that he is mostly present in his headquarters, so to speak, which is described as heaven. So everything other than God is created by God. Heaven had a beginning, as we understand it in the scriptures. And so you can't make God and heaven simultaneous, right, at the same. God is separate from his creation. Heaven is a finite place where finite beings like the angels, the seraphim, the cherubim, where the sons, plural, of God seem to come and go. And so oftentimes theologians will speak about a past heaven, referring to heaven as we can kind of understand it in the scriptures prior to the incarnation of Christ. Now remember, folks, we're talking about something that the Bible gives us hints about, but not a lot of details. And so when I say some of these things, you might be going, never heard that before. That's new to me. That's because a lot of us don't think much about heaven, which is sad. And then theologians talk about the present heaven, and that refers to where your loved ones and my loved ones who have passed away in Christ are waiting, are in his presence, I believe conscious in his presence. Where you're going to go and I'm going to go if I'm a follower of Christ when I die and this body's left behind and I go into what Jesus said to the man on the cross next to him, into paradise. And then there's this idea of future heaven, all right, which is what we heard read today, what you read in your scriptures if you're following along in Revelation chapter 21. But it's not a heaven up there. It's a heaven, if we listen carefully, it's a heaven, it's a hope that comes down here. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that next weekend. But I'm reminded of the words of Jesus in John chapter 14, verse 23. He said, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and the Father will love him." And look what it says. It says, "And we will come and make our home with him." Here, he comes to me. And so what happens spiritually is going to happen physically. His kingdom has begun in me spiritually, but someday his physical kingdom is going to come and we will be in his kingdom forever. Now let me give you an illustration. I've used it before, but it's worth repeating again. I want you to imagine that you're, although I've twisted a little bit this time, I want you to imagine that you are heading out for your family reunion, and it's going to be in one of the most beautiful islands in the Hawaiian Islands, in Kauai. Anybody ever been to Kauai? It is just beautiful. It's a paradise. It kind of, you know, you think about what heaven is like when you go. And the route you're going to take, though, is you're going to leave Minneapolis, MSP, and you're going to fly to LAX, to Los Angeles, and there all of your relatives, some who you have not seen for years, are going to meet. And then together you're going to board this plane. In fact, you have such a big family, it's chartered, right? And you're going to fly to Kauai. So you finally leave Minneapolis behind with all of its noise and issues and troubles like all our cities seems to have. And you land in LAX, and you go to the gate, and there's family already, because they've come from different parts of the country. And you guys just start your reunion right away. I mean, there's hugs, and there's tears, and there's laughter, and there's jokes. I mean, you haven't seen each other for so long. It's almost like you have this party. You don't even know that time is going by, and you hear a call to board the flight, and everybody kind of gets excited, and you all get on the flight, and the flight takes off. And you have a window seat. And you're looking down, and you expect you're at the very edge of the continental United States. You expect to be seeing blue water, and you don't. In fact, you feel the plane kind of make a little bit of a turn, actually a big turn. And you look down and you go, I think those are the Sierra Nevada. What's going on here? And then all of a sudden you're like, these are the Rockies. Those are the plains. There's Nebraska. Those funny circles in the ground where they, you know, water things. And then all of a sudden you hear the pilot come on and say, buckle up, because in 20 minutes you're going to be landing in Minnesota. And you're like, what on earth is going on? I'm supposed to be going to paradise in Kauai, and I'm coming back to Minnesota. It's August. Humidity, heat, mosquitoes. What? This is not where I want to have my family reunion. The plane lands and touches down. And everybody gets off the plane, and you walk out, and all of a sudden you notice, this is Minnesota, but it's not the Minnesota I left. There's no hospitals in Minnesota anymore. There's no prisons or jails. There's no human government structure. There's no poverty. There's no sickness. There's no tear. There's no pain. I mean, you look at it and you go, I know this. I know this is Minnesota. I just left a few hours ago, but this is not the Minnesota I left. There's no mosquitoes. There's no humidity. This is paradise. See, that's the story. That's the picture, right? We leave here, we go to be with the Lord, and guess what? We're coming back. But when we come back, it's a totally different place. We recognize it, we know it, but it's not what we left. That's because heaven has come to earth. That's because Christ now rules. His truth reigns. And like we heard in the scripture, and we'll talk more about this next weekend, all the tears are gone. All the sorrow's gone, all the crying, all the pain. Death is gone. There are no cemeteries. It is what God always planned it to be. Now, if that's true, does that give you hope today? It certainly gives me hope today. I did not hear a rousing amount of people say yes. You're all thinking, well, I'm going to go to Kauai. All right? So what makes hope so transforming for us? Let's look at the second idea, the transforming power of hope. How is it transformational? And I want to take us back to the early church for a few minutes. Our brothers and sisters in Christ early on, at different periods, went through some horrible times of persecution. And one of the worst was under the Emperor Domitian. He was very cruel. Now, understand, when we talk about Christians being persecuted in the ancient world, it's not like there is equal persecution in every place, right? There's some places that were pretty remote, and if they had a good governor, you know, maybe there wasn't as much persecution. But in the hubs, in the big cities, right, boy, there was a lot of persecution that the believers faced. I mean, they lost family, they lost friends, they were exiled, some of them like John, to Alipatmos to be a slave in the mines. They were crucified, they were beheaded, they were imprisoned, they were thrown to the lions for sport. And yet, one of them, a man by the name of Tertullian, who was a church apologist and a great writer who managed to get through all the persecution, said something that we've kept all the way down through church history. He said, you know, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. And what he meant by that is during these horrible times of persecution, the church actually multiplied and grew. Which, by the way, we have seen repeated throughout history, even to this very day. In places where there's the most severe persecution, oftentimes the church multiplies and it grows, which just boggles your mind because you don't expect during severe times of persecution when you're losing everything and you might be thrown to the lions that people are going to sign up and say, I want to be a Christian. What you expect is people to say, I am going to recant my faith. I don't want to be a Christian anymore. And some did, and some did. As Tertullian and other writers of the time, even secular writers, tell us, so many people endured their suffering and even went to their death with a sense of peace and poise in their lives. Why is that? How could they do that? To answer the question, I want to take you back to an incident that happened early on when believers were being persecuted. I want to talk a little bit about Stephen for just a moment. Now, Stephen was not persecuted by Domitian. He wasn't persecuted by the Romans. He was persecuted by his own people, by his own religious council. And over in Acts chapter 7, Stephen is standing before the council, and he's giving this powerful sermon. You ought to read it. And in the sermon, he accuses these religious leaders of being just like the heathen, which did not go down very well. And so we pick up the story in verse 54. It says the Jewish leaders were infuriated by Stephen's accusation, and they shook their fists at him in rage. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed steadily into heaven and saw the glory of God. And he saw Jesus standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. And he told them, look, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. Then they put their hands over their ears and began shouting. They rushed at him and dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. His accusers took off their coats and laid them at the feet of a young man named Saul. As they stoned him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He fell to his knees shouting, Lord, don't charge them with sin. And he died. And he died. Now, what is it that caused Stephen, who's being stoned to death, to ask God to forgive them for their sins? It's because he had a vision of his living hope. You see, that's how those early believers approached all their suffering and difficulties with such peace and poise. They had a vision in their minds and their hearts of their living hope. They knew that after their suffering, they were going to be with him. Now listen carefully. If there's anything I say, I want you to remember this today. Your vision and my vision of the future is going to determine our attitude and how we live in the present. Or as somebody else has put it, your then determines your now. Say it like this with me. Say, my then determines my now. And it does. It does. You know, if somebody were to follow you and me around for a couple of weeks and hear everything we say, and know everything we think, which is very scary, and everything that we do. And then they were asked by somebody, based on what you observed about Dale, or put your own name into this, what do you think his view of the future is? I wonder what they would say. Would they say, I don't think he believes there's a future. Boy, is he pessimistic. And negative. and hopeless. What would they say about you and me? Two people were hired for the same job, but on different days. The first person was taken to this room about the size of our worship center. If you're watching online, it's a large room if you are not part of us here in Minnesota. And when they walked into this room, it was like a big square box warehouse. It was painted very white, very bright. No windows, poor ventilation, and hanging from the ceiling down, fluorescent lighting with that buzz, you know? It just never ends. Boxes on one side of empty bottles, boxes on the other side with caps, and their job is to take the caps and screw them on the empty bottles. They're told that as they finish boxes, more will be added for them to keep on working. The job is 7 days a week, 8 hours a day. You get Christmas and Easter off, that's it. And the person's told, if you do the job well and you show up every day and you have a good attitude, we're going to pay you $25,000. Agreed? Person says yes. 2 weeks later, they quit. Not only do they quit, but they go on social media and they post that it's the worst company you can imagine to work for. It's a sweatshop. The conditions are abusive and the pay is pathetic. The other person who was hired on the second day is taken into a room adjacent to the other one, massive, big warehouse room. Same thing, painted white, no windows, poor ventilation, hanging lights, buzzing in your ear. They're told, here's your job, screw the caps on the bottles, and when you finish that, we'll add more in there. Do your job 7 days a week, 8 hours a day, 365 days. We'll give you Christmas and Easter off, and when you're done, at the end of it, if you do a good job and get everything done and show up, we're going to pay you $25 million. 2 weeks into the job, they post on social media, this is the best job anybody could ever have. I love the company I'm working for. It is just amazing. I go into work and I'm sorry I have to leave. I get up early because I can't wait to go to my job the next day. What's the difference between person one and person two? What they're going to get at the end, right? What do you believe you're going to get at the end? And how is it affecting how you live in the present? Which raises a very interesting question that I want to look at with you, and that is simply this. How does one get the hope that transforms? How do you get that in your mind, in your heart, in your system? How do you get the kind of hope that just causes you, no matter how bad it is down here, to endure? See, next weekend, I want to talk to you as we close out next weekend. I want to tell you why as followers of Christ, we are more pessimistic than the most pessimistic person. But listen to this, we are more optimistic than the most optimistic person. How can that be? Well, in part, what we're about to talk about helps us understand that. How is it that this hope transforms our lives? If you go back to the reading of the passage that we just had, I want to draw your attention to verse 6. It says, and he also said, it is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, which means the beginning and the end. Then it says, to all who are what? To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. And later on in chapter 22, we're going to talk about the river of life. Now let's read this aloud together, because I really want us to get this. Ready? And he also said, it is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. What does he mean by that? Well, to unpack that, I want to take you back to an incident in John chapter 4 that we've looked at before. In John chapter 4, Jesus shows up at a well. It's the middle of the day. It's in Samaritan territory. It's hot. He's thirsty. He has sent his disciples into the village of Sychar, Samaritan village, to get some groceries. And while he's sitting there, a woman, a Samaritan woman, comes out. And Jesus meets her at the well, and he says, "I'm thirsty." In other words, I have a physical thirst, and I'd like that to be met. And she's kind of put off by Jesus' request, and she looks at him, and she says, "How is it that you, a Jew, a rabbi, are talking to me, a woman, a Samaritan? That just doesn't happen." And look how Jesus responds to her. Jesus replied, "If you only knew the gift God has for you." Isn't that wonderful? That's a great way to start a conversation with somebody, isn't it? He doesn't start out by saying, if you only knew how sinful you really were. He says, if you only knew the gift God has for you and who you're speaking to, you would ask me and I would give you Gatorade. No, I would give you living water. Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. So Jesus, it's like Jesus is giving her a preview of what he's going to tell John later on that we just read in Revelation chapter 21. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life. So Jesus plays off physical thirst, doesn't he? He says, just like when you're physically thirsty, you want something that will quench your physical thirst. He says to her, you know what? I've got something that will quench your spiritual thirst, your soul thirst. What is soul thirst? You know, soul thirst is that thirst in our lives for true love. Soul thirst is that thirst in our lives for forgiveness, for acceptance, for mercy, for identity. We hear so much today about identity. Why do we hear so much today about identity? And we'll answer that next weekend. But I'll tell you one reason why is because we lack a sense of significance. We lack a sense of who we really are. We're so confused. We long for that. That's that soul thirst. And Jesus says, if you believe in me, if you trust me, I'll make sure you never have that thirst for love, forgiveness, acceptance, significance, identity ever again. Keller says the key to understanding that is to go to John chapter 19. In John chapter 19, Jesus is hanging on the cross. And one of the things that he says on the cross while he's hanging there suffering is, I what? I thirst. Now, I am sure Jesus was physically thirsty. I mean, the brutal suffering he had been through, he must have been parched, dehydrated. But you know, the physical thirst of our Lord, I think, actually points to a deeper thirst that he had. Jesus on the cross was experiencing cosmic thirst. The thirst of this universe, the thirst of every human being who longs for love, who longs for forgiveness, who longs for acceptance, who longs for identity. He was feeling our thirst in his soul, and his Father turned his face away from his Son, and Jesus died of thirst. Your thirst and my thirst. Why? So we could have our thirst quenched by God's love and God's forgiveness and God's acceptance and God's grace. He drank, as we said last weekend, he drank our cup of suffering so we could drink his cup of grace. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that wonderful? We have so much hope, don't we? So much hope. That no matter how hard this life gets, no matter how challenged our world becomes, oh my goodness, the hope that's yours, the hope that's mine. I want to ask you a question, point blank, straight down the sights question. Do you know what's going to happen to you after you die? You know, if you're a materialist or you know people who are materialists who believe that you live and this is it and then you die, I want to tell you something. I cannot imagine a more hopeless experience. Even if you have a humanitarian attitude of, yeah, I know I'm going to live and die and become fertilizer. In the meantime, I'm going to try to do everything good to bring hope in this world. I want to tell you something that is illogical. It makes absolutely no sense. Because what you call bringing hope to the world, someone else might say, you're not bringing hope to the world. I don't like your idea of hope. I'm going to impose my idea of hope. It's a waste of time. It's a wasted life. There's no sense of having morality, and there's no sense of having any kind of overarching truth. It's really every man, every woman for themselves. It's going to end in chaos. It's amazing we have destroyed ourselves already if that's the view we take. And increasingly, as we see that view being taken, we see how we're destroying ourselves. But if you believe that after you die, you're going to stand before the God of the Bible, then that means you know that you're going to face a day of judgment. And only those who have fallen into the arms of Jesus, only those who have placed their faith and trust in him are going to enter into the new heaven and reign with Christ on the new earth. And those who have rejected Christ and rejected truth are going to spend an eternity in hell. Now let me ask you a question. Where are you going to spend your eternity? Let's pray. If you're here today, and I don't think we can get any more clearer, and you're uncertain about your future, I urge you, I compel you today to say yes to Jesus, to surrender yourself entirely to him. And if you're prepared to do that, when you leave this worship center at both doors, 1 and 2, you're going to see a big placard there that says, I said yes. And I want you to go there and I want you to tell the people there, I want to say yes to Jesus today. I want to surrender to him today. And they're going to pray with you. And they give you material to help you get on with your journey. But I want you to want it so bad. I want you to be so thirsty. You're actually willing to go and say, I want to say yes. So someone there can help you make that decision. I don't want to just rattle off a little prayer in this room that we blindly, numbly pray and think that because we dotted the I and crossed the T, everything's good. No, you have to be thirsty enough to say, I'm going to go get that drink. For the rest of us, my goodness, if you know where you're going to go, if you know what's awaiting you, you ought to be the most optimistic person in the world. You ought to have a sense of overwhelming joy and hope. And so that's why we're going to close by singing a song that we normally sing at Easter time. I've asked Pastor Dave to come and lead it. And I want you to sing it like you have hope. I love the last stanza of the song, soar we now where Christ has led, following our exalted head. Made like him we rise. Ours the cross, the grave, the skies. Amen. Let's stand. Pastor Dave, would you lead us, please?
Take out your pew hymnal, please, and turn with me to 234. Christ the Lord is risen today.
joining us for service today. If you are here today and you want to make that decision to say yes, then there's a little pamphlet like this that is waiting for you with one of our staff members out in the common space behind a huge sign that says, "I said yes." You literally can't miss it. And the folks there would just be honored to have that conversation with you. And as Dale indicated, if you are feeling compelled, you have that thirst, please do stop by there. A couple weeks ago, I was running a trail race on a course that was just brutal. And I was coming up what I found out later to be the final hill, thinking to myself, is this ever going to end? And I got to the top of that hill, and someone who had finished the course ahead of me was jogging back on the course to do his cool down. And he was encouraging some of his fellow runners. And he said to me as I came up the hill, he said, "Only 2 more minutes and you're at the finish. Stay strong." Jesus is returning soon. And the finish line of our faith is extraordinary. Wooddale, stay strong. God bless you as you go.